So hello, I'm Linden Tibbets, CEO of a company called IFT. I couldn't be more excited to speak here at Twilio Signal. I think really want to acknowledge back in front of a developer kind of API-centric audience is fantastic. One of the things, IFT has been around since, I've been working on it back since 2008, 2009. We've integrated over, I think we're at 445 services on the platform. And actually, the service number 4 and number 5 was SMS and phone call. So I think it went email, Twitter, weather, and then Twilio. Twilio was a big part of what made IFT popular in the early days, and also one of the big reasons we hustled to raise a seed round. Those SMS messages are pretty damn expensive, if you know what I mean. So excited to talk to you today about building applications in a future of more, and also would love to announce something we're actually launching today, something that's out and available. We'll talk more about that as we get going. So, jumping into it, I want to talk about Jeff Bezos and Amazon. Jeff is famous for, among lots of other things, his booming laugh and I'd say this very particular shit-eating grin. Sometimes I wonder if this isn't where the smile in the Amazon logo comes from. He's got this like twinkle in his eye. He knows something that we don't know. I'm sure of it. I think what that is that he's aware of an entirely different and ingenious way to think about the future. And it's actually pretty simple. So Jeff gets asked all the time, what's going to change in the future? Which he says, it seems like a really good question, right? Well, what's going to change? However, he contends that asking about what's going to change is actually a terrible way to think about the future. Instead, if you're building a business, instead you should ask what isn't going to change. What's going to stay the same? And effectively, it's those things that are going to stay the same in the future that you can build your business on top of. It effectively becomes the foundation. So thinking about and searching for these constant truths can really shed light on tremendous problems and opportunities that are looming on the horizon. So, without too much additional fanfare, I'd like to present 3 things that you can be absolutely sure of are going to be the same, or in this case, more of, 10 years from now. So the first of those is, in 10 years, there will only be more services. And I don't know how emphatically I can state this. This is the biggest force for change, actual change, in our time. But it's largely invisible. Venture capitalist Marc Andreessen calls it software eating the world. Futurist Kevin Kelly says our nouns are becoming verbs, and ownership is turning into access. Whatever the internet touches, tracks, or empowers, it's forever changed from a thing into a service. CDs turn into Spotify, DVDs into Netflix, car ownership into Uber and Lyft. Nest is temperature control as a service. Philips Hue is lighting as a service. Every single object in this room that you can point to and name will be connected to and tracked by the internet. And when it is, it becomes a service. And it's not just startups, it's not just objects, it's not just things. It's every company, every product, every organization will become a service in the future, or frankly, it's going to cease to exist. It won't be a thing anymore. When GE and Ford say that they're now software companies, something's up. And really, unlike static products, these services, they're fluid. They're experiences, and they change and adapt over time. Services get to know you, and in the future, you can be sure that there'll only be more services getting to know you than you could possibly imagine. So the third thing that I think in 10 years is going to be true is there are only going to be more interfaces. So if you think you're getting too much internet now, you are going to hate the future. The ways that we interact with our digital services will only continue to diversify, and they're only going to take up more of our waking hours. It's popular to think, actually, that each new interface replaces the last. Like right now, we're big into this mobile thing, apparently, and like VR, AR, that's coming. But what's really funny is that, going all the way back, TV didn't kill the radio. Radio's alive and well. I listen to an hour of podcast every day on my walk to and from work. Mobile didn't actually kill the browser. The browser didn't actually kill the desktop. New interfaces are largely additive. And we've got this kind of avalanche of new interfaces that are on the horizon coming our way. And I'm sure more than one of those is going to stick. So just to name a few really quick, AR, VR, AI voice assistants, more screens of every shape and size. Why do you need a screen on your refrigerator? I don't know, but you're probably going to like it soon. Gesture-based and presence controls, cars, TVs, wearables, chatbots, those are still around. Can you even imagine the development team you're going to need to support all these interfaces for your service in the future? It's going to be big. So the last thing of the three things I think are pretty easy to say, going to be true in the future, 10 years from now, there's only going to be more data. And you're here at the Twilio conference. Many of you are developers. I'm guessing you probably don't need another asshole like myself on stage. I don't have a face mic, but I'm going to say big data. I'm going to talk about it anyways, because I think, honestly, the scope of what big data or more data means is really hard for us, you know, kind of linearly and spatially thinking humans to grasp. So some quick things. 90% of all digital data was created in just the last few years. From gigs to terabytes to petabytes, we're literally running out of prefixes. Tracking is the new normal. We're gonna track everything, every single thing. And depending on the scale that you track something, you know, and you can get really, really fine grained with it, talking molecules and stuff, there's probably more data uncaptured in this room since I began talking than has been created all time. So the vast majority of the data, you know, I think what's really funny about this unimaginable amount of data coming our way, the vast majority of that data is actually private. It's inaccessible. It's locked away in a silo and is essentially useless to anyone else but the owners of that silo. So all this data could be valuable to someone or somewhere, somehow. And you know, a lot of people like to talk about this idea that data is the new oil. But it's not a commodity. It's not all created equal, and most of it's locked away. The thing that is going to be true, though, is there are only going to be more of it. So those things said, you know, more is better, right? More choices, more services, interfaces, and data. I like choice. I like more. Sounds like we're headed for a future of abundance. Or more can also look like this. More isn't always better. Every new connected device that's announced today kind of evokes this feeling of dread. You know, a connected trash can, a refrigerator with a touchscreen, an Alexa built in, internet-connected vibrator for couples with a companion app. Do we really need all this stuff? And each new connected device is a new service. It's a new interface. It's a whole lot more new data. And I think what's even more scary is it all may or may not work with all the stuff we already have. Your phone, your Facebook, your carrier plan, your Amazon Prime account. I think we're right to feel overwhelmed. We're right to really kind of push back on this stuff. This future of more doesn't really seem like abundance. Instead, it seems like complexity. It seems opaque, and it seems, above all, incompatible. And it's this last thing, compatibility or incompatibility, that I really want to talk about. You know, this idea of more is the arch nemesis of compatibility. It's this dread that more brings is actually baked into the very fundamentals of our industry as a computing industry. In fact, we've got a law for it. Once computers got involved, the rate of technological progress became exponential. And the potential for incompatibility grew as a function of each new device, each new service, each new interface, and every kind of new piece of data that we introduced to the market. So incompatibility, I think, is just a much bigger problem. It's much bigger than just a bunch of new dongles every time Apple releases a new phone and does away with a port. As we surround ourselves with more services, more interfaces, more data, there's no guarantee that this stuff is going to work together. And I'm not just talking about the connected home. Take AI assistants. AI, there's so much excitement around AI. It depends on this compatibility. It depends on access. Specifically, AI depends on the type of compatibility and access that allows it to know something about who you are and then do something for you. And without that kind of access, any type of assistant or AI it might as well be as good as Einstein locked in a dark closet. Can't communicate with anybody, can't do anything, can't affect the world. And the sheer volume of APIs in which services are going to need to access, or API services are going to need to access, is such a major blocker for unlocking this true potential and this excitement around AI. This idea of kind of more versus compatibility, I think, is the very story of technology. It's kind of simplicity versus complexity. It's this idea of it just works versus a confusing mess. And what's really funny about it is, I believe this battle against more isn't new. It's one that we've actually kind of won a number of times over ever since the invention of computers and the internet. And you know, you can kind of guess who some of the big winners were, some of the heroes, I like to think, that conquered the evil foes of more and incompatibility. They look like this, and you guessed it. I like to call them the dominant portals. You know, Microsoft Windows tamed the confusion of the desktop, provided a single platform for developers to build great applications. They brought the PC to millions of people, despite never manufacturing one, until recently. Google, they brought order to the infinite vastness of the web, a single HTML field that brought the web to the masses. Apple, as the web became more private and personal, Apple brought us apps and the most personal device ever created, the iPhone. Amazon, and I think, you know, we started talking about Jeff, but you know, their name evokes the vastness of the everything store. They brought simplicity to commerce, everything you could possibly imagine buying online, all in one place, at the lowest price, delivered to your door within days, sometimes hours. And then finally, Facebook. They brought every person you've ever met, and all the ones you haven't, they brought them all together into one place. They made your social connections online actually manageable. And I spend time talking about these five companies. They're all so familiar, and I think we understand just how important a role they played in our lives is. But I think they have a couple things in common that we maybe don't acknowledge. One, they're well-meaning, dominant portals. They brought us simplicity and usability in the face of more. They were kind of our conquering heroes. The other thing is, they're all still around, and they're massive businesses. You know, collectively here, this is, I think you might even say this is the top five most valuable companies in the world, or at least the top 10. And I think what's so funny about that, in their growing numbers, these very saviors are really now part of the problem. They are contributing to more. So for instance, don't expect to order something on Amazon with Google Assistant anytime soon. It's not going to happen. You can't really search for photos your friend took on Instagram a year ago with Google. And don't even get me started on whatever the hell Apple is doing with HomeKit. So how could this happen? You know, I'm going to pick on one. And again, I'm not saying let's bring out the pitchforks. I want to be really nice here because, again, these are our heroes. These companies, are very well-intentioned. But here's Google's mission. Their mission is to organize the world's information and make it universally accessible and useful. However, who is that information accessible to? And who is it useful to? I would argue that it's not universally accessible. The most useful information Google's organized is your information, and you can't use it in other places. If you're a developer that needs some of that information and can do something really interesting and valuable with it, good luck getting access, especially if you're not part of the Google ecosystem in a big way. So there's now this massive imbalance, I think. And that said, I think there's also a solution. And as is the case with many foreseeable problems in the future, I think we can find inspiration in how we've solved similar problems in the past. Our basic physical world is so compatible, we take it for granted. I'll tell you a funny thing that you'll think is really ridiculous, but if you want to wear your Levi's jeans and drink a Starbucks coffee in your Honda or your Toyota car, you can totally do that. You don't have to sign any waivers. There's no OAuth. There's no kind of special API. It would seem silly if the brands in our physical world weren't 100% compatible all the time. And that's exactly the opposite of how things work in our digital world. So really, to kick things off, I want to talk about another type of standard that required a whole lot of fighting for, and I think really one of the most underappreciated innovations in the last century, the shipping container. And as a fellow developer, my guess is you maybe heard this metaphor before. I think it's still a valuable story and valuable to hear again. It's really worth revisiting. After industrialization unleashed its own onslaught of more, in this case, more consumer goods, more products, the adoption of shipping containers in the 1950s and 60s tamed this onslaught. They brought on globalization, they created immeasurable amounts of new wealth, and they raised living standards the world over. And in retrospect, the standard container seemed so obvious, but even 60 years ago, it was kind of hard to see. It wasn't something a lot of people were talking about. This is what docks look like pre-containerization. Everything had its own custom container. Bananas one, wine in another, car tires in a third. Worse still, it all had to be manually unloaded and unpacked. They called this incompatible mess break bulk cargo. And it was slow, backbreaking work for thousands of dock workers. And then in the 1950s, along came this fellow, Malcolm McLean. He owned a truck company. He had the foresight to see through this incompatible mess. And his big insight was that organizations, frankly, they didn't give a damn about how their goods were packed or whether they arrived via boat or train or on horses or camels. All they cared about was that it arrived on time and in one piece at a low price. And so this seemingly simple insight really pushed him to question every step and kind of all the steps in the status quo. And he eventually designed and championed the world's first interchangeable shipping container. And it took decades. Carriers and shippers had to decide on many competing standards. There were dozens of standards in the US alone. Ports had to strengthen their wharves, create connections to rail lines and highways. The dock worker unions fought it every step of the way. Imagine this, it's almost kind of like developers unionizing and fighting the standardization of APIs. It wasn't easy, but it was worth it. When Malcolm finished, the world had been forever changed. McLean and his containers reduced the process of loading and unloading shipping containers from 4 days to just 8 hours. This is a radical savings in cost and time. And as a result, consumers enjoyed not just lower prices, but access to things that no one would have ever even considered shipping before. It created entirely new markets. It unlocked new behaviors and businesses that couldn't have been predicted before standardization. So compatibility, in a way, brought businesses and governments and entire cultures closer together than ever before. And they effectively grew the pie for everybody. So snap back to our kind of oncoming future of more digital stuff. When our digital services work together, they don't ship atoms, they ship bits. And if we want to unlock the untold amounts of value in our service silos, I think we need a standard for shipping data. And you might ask, well, we've already got some standards, things like HTTP, REST, Bluetooth, since this is the Signal Conference, SMS is a standard as well. And these are just, these standards, I think, are just like the trains, trucks, and ships prior to containerization. They're fantastic standards. They're great for a specific domain, but they're also not compatible, and they don't work very well together. And then, what about APIs? We've got APIs. Now we're getting somewhere. But which one? Which API? Everybody has a worked with program or some custom API. Nest, iPhone, HomeKit, Honeywell, so on and so forth. And these APIs are really far from neutral. In fact, they're all specifically built with the intention of becoming a dominant portal for that industry over time. The best thermostat or the best car. For instance, on IFT, we have 12 different connected lighting systems. Each one of them turns on and off a light bulb in a slightly different way. So in many ways, these APIs are contributing, again, to this future of more, this kind of onslaught of more things that we'll have to deal with. So think of the custom APIs really as the breakbulk cargo before standard containerization. So we're getting closer. I think we don't just need a standard for shipping data. We need a standard for APIs. And I think here's where the usefulness of the shipping container analogy begins to wear off. And we have to break some new ground. So one, shipping data with APIs is just fundamentally different. And I think why that's different is that in a world of data and APIs, it's not just about services talking to services or things talking to things. People are involved too, and we're involved at every step of the way. And it's our data. It's things that, that we have ownership on one service and another. And so you have to begin thinking about a standard for APIs that both users and services can trust. And this type of standard, I think, creates new types of businesses that don't depend on becoming the world's best-selling thermostat or the world's biggest retail chain to achieve some level of compatibility with other services. So this is exactly what we've been thinking about at IFTTTT for the last 8 years, a standard for how your data gets shipped back and forth between services that really depends on trust and transparency and bring users and services together in the same place to make decisions about how all this stuff works, how all this data and how all this access should work together. We have these things we call applets. And I like to call applets toggle switches for your reality made possible by APIs. So if you're familiar with the history of our company, applets go well beyond or will go well beyond this idea of if this, then that. They turn on with a simple switch, and you know some of them sound a little toy-like right now. My favorite one, we did some with Domino's, you know, turn on your LifeX porch lights when your Domino's pizza is out for delivery. Or others like always be prepared for the weather, rain or shine with your calendar and a notification and an email. But at the end of the day, These are really interesting. These are stories about how your services can work together to create a brand new experience that wasn't possible with any one service. To date, we've added 50 million applets. Think of those as kind of like downloads. We have over 300,000 applets have been published on the platform. We have 11 million users, a billion applet runs per month, and over 440 API services published. And this is where we start getting to some really exciting stuff. We have over 200,000 individual developers that have plugged in some type of API, in many of these cases a private API, for themselves. So I'd love to show a really quick demo. And I'll switch over to here. So this is our platform, and really this is the kind of the individual view of our platform, what an individual we call Maker can see. And I've got one published applet. You can have a private applet, archive. I've got a lot of old stuff, what we used to call recipes. And we dig into, we'll take a look at one of my private applets that I've already built here. So I built a special one, kind of a hello world for the Signal conference, and I'll show you how it works. So this is one, send yourself a text message on a hello world with Google Assistant. So you're able to kind of say, okay, well, if I say a certain thing to Google Assistant, you know, a certain phrase, I'm going to say text my phone, or I might say SMS my phone, or I might say message my phone. There's all these different ways to say text. And then Google Assistant is going to say something back. I've texted your phone with this message. You can write some JavaScript here, some what we call filter code. This allows me, so right here I'm inspecting whether or not that message actually exists. So the user might just say, okay, Google, text my phone, and not say anything after that. So I check for that, and in that case, I insert another message that says, hello, world. But if I did say something after that message, well, that's what we'll go ahead and send down here in the SMS. So you're able to kind of string these stories together about how APIs work. Right now, it's still very much based on if something happens, then do something else, and some other stuff. You can add an additional action, but where we're going with this is there is no structure. It could be give me access to every connected device in your house, or give me this level of access, and these are the APIs I need to tell this type of story for my customer. You go ahead and fill out kind of what it is here, and here it is, kind of living live on our website, and you can also embed these within your own applications. And we're kind of getting better and better at making these more native to your experience. So I go ahead and turn these on. Boom. And so now if I say, okay, Google, send me an SMS or text my phone, it would work. So that's our demo. And hop back over here. We're really excited today, actually, very good timing. We're actually open sign up. So anybody can now sign on to our platform, build and publish applets, build them for yourself, publish them for others. And this is really the free tier for our platform. We're very, very excited about it. We've already had tens of thousands of folks jump on. build and publish an applet. And there's just, you know, when you think about it, there's infinite ways in which APIs can work together to tell a story. And we'd love to ask that this group here and anybody else that signs up really helps us fill in all those gaps, helps us uncover what are the most powerful and interesting stories that you might be able to tell. So with that, thank you so much. Enjoy your conference.